There's only one spot left in the finals for the first major of the season, and Jason Belmonte is out to grab it with both hands. But to get there, Belmo will have to overpower three others, a veteran, a rookie, and one of his best friends, Mike Fagan. It's the Aulby division of the PBA World Championship, and it starts right now. Welcome to Las Vegas' South Point Casino and Convention Center. Today we'll determine the fourth and final competitor for the first major of this season, the PBA World Championship. Today's four finalists include the three-time All-American from St. John's University, Mike Fagan.
A loose arm swing, power, and revolutions. That's how he rolls.
Another collegiate standout, the Wichita State product, Josh Blanchard.
A three-time first-team All-American making his first-ever telecast.
From Dayton, Ohio, the Buckeye, Brian Kretzer.
Won his only title in 2010, now looking to win his first major.
And your number three overall seed from Orange, New South Wales, Australia, Belmo, Jason Belmonte.
The two-handed freak of nature, looking to put his opponents away, down under.
How long did you work on that pun, Randy?
Because
you nailed it.
Friend.
It was very good. Eliminator format here. And as the World Series of Bowling rolls on, all four will go. Low score, out. Top three roll on again to match two till we're down to two. The winner will be the fourth and final finalist for the PBA World Championship. Jason Belmonte, the high seed here in this division. So he got to pick the oil pattern, and he selected the 43-foot shark.
And no surprise, you know why? Because Chris Barnes told me high rev players like the longer oil pattern.
Mike Fagan starting us off on the left lane. Great start. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson, Chris Barnes, glad you're with us today from Las Vegas. Oscu Palermo, Ryan Schaefer, and last week Sean Rash. Those three have advanced to the PBA World Championship Finals. One of these four will join them. Your number three overall seed, Jason Belmonte. His best finish at the World Championships, a seventh in 2010.
See here, Belmo's going with a little bit of surface right off the bat, trying to get the ball to pick up. That one picks up a little bit quick. Lots of rev rate on this show. Lots of transition in this first game and a half.
Hey, Chris, you have kind of some low expectations as far as high scoring going on this one. This one seems more lined up to be a kind of a gritty gutty game.
Yeah, last week we saw tremendous scores. Guys played throw to the right. They broke them down correctly. Tons of rev rate. Guys are playing in already with surface. They're going to keep breaking down. Guys are going to have a hard time keeping up with those moves. And it's going to make that down lane oil appear even tighter.
Blanchard leaves the 10, his first shot. In front of the TV lights. Brian Kretzer, one PBA Tour title on his resume. Won it in March of 2010 in Norwich, Connecticut. Good start for Kretzer. Blanchard steps up on the left to close out. Blanchard grew up in Los Angeles, recently moved to Phoenix after getting married a couple months ago.
So a lot of new and exciting things going on here in Josh's life, and that includes his time right here in Vegas.
I came out here kind of just to learn. My wife said, go try and see how it is. And so I just came out here to try, and I failed the first day miserably. With flying colors, I failed. And after that, I learned the next day, drilled a couple balls. All of a sudden, 12th place the next day, 10th place the next day, 6th place the next day, and now I'm on the show for the World Championships.
Blanchard, a three-time All-American in college, as was this young man, Mike Fagan, as he starts off the second frame. Mike made just one show last year, the Geico Shark Championship, where he finished fifth, and the year before that, He was second to Jack Jurek in the same tournament, losing in a roll-off. So we know he's pretty comfortable on this Shark Oil pattern, which, by the way, you can try out if you join a PBA Experience League. Check with your local bowling center.
Even with all those revolutions, that ball didn't turn up into the pocket quite hard enough, leaving the shaker 8-10.
My opinion is on this particular pattern that if there's a time to beat Belmonte, it's this game. If it keeps going, I think he just keeps getting stronger.
And he only has to beat one player, so in this format, that should bode well for him, wouldn't you think?
I think so, but the reason is this. Speed kills on this pattern. And even with all those revs, ball speed's still pretty high. It's much higher than all the rest of the guys on this show. As soon as the lanes start to hook a little bit and he has some friction with that dull ball, I don't think he's going to have any trouble at all.
So with what you're telling me, then, this should really favor a guy like Brian Kretzer.
I think it does for quite a while.
And Kretzer with an opening double to back up your statement.
Just because of the speed thing, once they start to hook enough, his rev rate doesn't match up as well as some of the other guys. I think he gets in trouble the longer it goes, and they force him really far left.
Gotcha.
Josh. Cut it too close and whiffs. And his wife, Amy, the stoic approach. She's making her TV debut as well. It's a lot of pressure on the wives out here. Sean Rash's wife getting a lot of airtime this season already. We'll see a lot more of her and Sean. Sean last week advancing to the finals of PBA World Championship. What a showdown. What a show it was last week. Pete Weber, Sean Rash, stepping up and delivering some top-notch entertainment. Belmo spare open frame. Here he is in the third. Struck the pose and gets him to go.
That shot there had more revolutions than a small Central American country. Watch this. You want to see some sick pin action? Head pin, sidewall, 10 pin. You're done.
Fagan with the spare as I try to fully digest that comment. Kretzer, his effort in the third. Three for three is Brian Kretzer. Only his eighth televised appearance. First for this young man, Josh Blanchard. What have you seen from him out on the tour so far, Chris?
Well, we didn't see him much there, but I saw him bowl a lot in college at my alma mater, Wichita State. And this guy's got a ton of game. It won't be long before we see a lot of him, I think, out here.
Big learning curve, though, when you get with the big boys and then you take it to the lights and the TV cameras.
This is not a great pairing for him. Got a lot of rev rate, a lot of guys left of him. He rolls the ball a lot in the front, and he probably needs more of a range speed-wise to be able to move far enough left and stay slow enough to not get caught in the middle.
Back-to-back open frames.
Not how you want to start on TV, my friend. How you want to start? You want to do what Brian Kretzer's done. Three straight strikes. He's on top. Top three move on. The conclusion of match number one when we return to Las Vegas. The PBA World Championship is brought to you by Budweiser. Great times are waiting. Grab some Buds. By Alka-Seltzer Plus. Alka-Seltzer Plus liquid gels provide more complete cold relief than NyQuil. By Hammer Bowling. Nothing hits like a hammer. And by the USBC and its 2 million members. To find out more about USBC, log on to bowl.com today.
Badge with us back here in beautiful Las Vegas. World Championship finalists, three of them have been determined. Palermo, Schaefer, Rash. Who will join them in the finals? Mike Aulby division continues here, match number one. Mike Fagan grew up in Long Island. Standout bowler there, won the New York State Public High School Athletic Association Championship all the way back in 97 as a junior. Great success. St. John's University. And now two PBA Tour titles to his credit.
Wait. Strike there for Fagan, and he and Belmo best mates, as Jason likes to say. But Belmo experiences mixed feelings when competing with his buddy on the lanes.
It's difficult bowling against someone who's one of your best friends as well, because you obviously don't want him to strike so much. But, you know, you do, because you want him to do well. So it's mixed, like the guy who I kind of just expect to do well every week. He's so versatile. He can throw the ball as straight as Walter Ray Williams and curve it as much as me. And when you have that in your bag, you're pretty competitive every week.
Belmo with a strike there as he sits down. That is the Earl Anthony PBA World Championship Trophy. One of these four guys will have a shot next week to try and claim it. Blanchard, oh boy.
Yeah, it's going to be three opens in a row for him. Boy, I remember my first at the bottom. Telecast ever. 154 against David Ozio, Tucson, Arizona, 1985. What a nightmare.
Ran you over by about nine.
Really?
Yeah. Leading the tournament. Chief only beat me about 70.
While you two guys reminisce over here, Kretzer left the 10 pin. Blanchard.
Well, he's letting everybody get loose here.
4-6-7.
That's a lineup shot. He's got to do something different. I don't even hate that play right there. You don't like giving up the count, but if the next one doesn't hit the pocket, it's going to be so too far behind to even matter.
I think that's a smart play. Real smart play. Try to get lined up with a different bowling ball, because what he's doing right now isn't working.
Yeah, he's got to pick up tens, not twos.
Leaderboard through four. Kretzer still on top. Blanchard trailing Belmonte by 33.
3-6-10.
3-6-10 left for Belmo.
And that might as well be the PBA washout.
3-6-10. Throw the nine pin in there and it is.
Well, then it's about the big four.
Yeah.
What do you think about Michael's approach here this first game? The line he's playing.
I think it's real interesting that he's going as straight as he is with as much speed as he's using. And I think that's why he's experiencing some pretty lousy pin carry right now.
That tells me that he thinks the scoring pace this first game isn't going to be very high.
Whoa, how about that? 10 got blocked. Open frame for Belmo.
Blanchard finds a way into a double, and he's back in within single pins.
Third nine spare for Fagan to go with his two strikes. Kretzer opened up with a three bagger, nine spare in the fourth. Here he is in the fifth.
Fourth strike there for BK, and here is Brian on why he started bowling.
I love the sport. You know, it's something that, you know, if you're not 6'1 and can run a 4.440, you can still be a bowler. And I was 5'10 and a little skinny white kid. I couldn't play sports anymore. But bowling was something you could do. And like I said, I got good at it. And whenever you're good at something, it's a lot more enjoyable. And fortunately, I got really, really good at it.
Big Ohio State fan, also follows the Cincinnati Reds. Remember correctly, a couple of years ago, he came out in a scarlet and gray jersey. I might have even been in Columbus, if I'm not mistaken.
See what Blanchard has here. A little change.
Got the seven for now. Better than last time.
2-4.
Unbelievable.
Spares aren't getting any easier for him here either.
2-5-8. Not exactly routine.
You can hear him explain. He squares up. It hooks early. Gets left. Goes by it. This is where he has to gear down his speed and give it time to read the lane. A lot easier to see from here.
Stop the bleeding, Rob.
Tourniquet applied. It was spare. That's the deficit he has to make up. Down 18 pins. Here's Fagan. His third strike, and earlier we heard Belmo talk about his buddy Mick. Now here's Fagan on his friend from the land down under.
He's always, you know, the X factor. You gotta realize he's one of those people that you have to watch because he can destroy a lane. I mean, the oil just spreads out and evaporates because of the way he throws the ball, the amount of revolutions, and you know, you have to always be wary of what he's doing because his ball is going to affect your shot. I mean, there's no two ways about it.
Jason Belmonte up. He's already had two open frames, one in the second, one in the fifth. Here he is in the sixth on the left.
Oh, that's a lot better.
They liked it, and for good reason.
Yeah, that was a little better.
He's already in the fourth arrow, out to 10. Look at the six, just snapped the 10 out. If he continues to move on, he's just going to continue to move to the left.
Blanchard still seeking his first strike under the lights. Got a chance.
Another ball change. Finally something that read the oil pattern better.
Something for his wife, Amy, to cheer about.
An accomplished surfer in her own right.
Hanging 10.
Hanging 10.
Nice. That's okay because there's no 10 pin with it, just the 2 pin.
Pretty good sign you're doing the right thing. Seemed like when anytime, not only when you threw good shots that you didn't strike, but when the bad ones started to split, there's a pretty good sign that you're throwing the wrong ball this week.
Jason Belmonte, still just one PBA Tour title. Came in 09. There's a good looking strike. He and Sean Rash had a wonderful start to the World Series of Bowling. Those two guys trying to carry it over. When the paychecks are written and the trophies are handed out. Airmailed by Kretzer. I don't think that was a search mission either.
Definitely not.
A little problem with the approaches.
We've seen some issues on that left lane with the approach. Saw it last week. Pete Weber had a couple issues with it.
General thought when they're kind of hard that you just throw it straight at them.
Fagan still without a double.
It just looks to me like it's too straight. Too straight and too hard.
Yeah. Again, the only thing I can see here, he didn't have a great ball reaction in practice. It looked like he had too much polish on most of his stuff. But he's got to think the scoring pace just isn't that high, and then he can get through by shooting 1-9 or 2-0. And right now,
down there, and you don't have to shoot.
Looks pretty good.
Fifth strike for Kretzer. He continues to chew himself out. Michael going after the four. Now he's staring at the approach.
But see, he threw the ball straight at that single pin spare like Chris mentioned. Throw it straight. A lot of times you can get away with sticking at the foul line. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely. It's, you know, when you just, the lanes are a little touchy. It doesn't take much for it to get out of line here.
Blanchard to step up and close out the seventh. He's got some turf to make up.
Oh, Brooklyn maybe? Oh,
good. What a decel on that one, Joshua. The ring knew it's tighter, so don't throw it right. Just keep it in.
If you guys had a moment to pull him alone right now, what would you whisper into his ear and help him out here, Randy?
I'd say at this point, why don't you just try to have as much fun as you can. He seems awfully tight, and that's due to the fact that he got off to such a poor start. Right now, try to enjoy the last four frames of this game. I always look back at last year's TSC and what Tom Doherty did against Mika, when Mika almost pulled 300, shot 299, and Tom Doherty shot 100.
Barely.
But you know what? He had some fun with it at the end. He was extremely gracious.
Had the whole crowd behind him.
Yeah, and so it made for a good watch, and it made it fun.
Fagan, only one strike here on this right lane, came all the way back in the first frame. No strikes there. And that run continues, leaving the 6-7-9. More pain here on the right lane. Take another look. Straight, off target, through the nose. Up now, Buddy Belmo trying for a three-bagger.
Ouch.
Left the nine.
Remember, low score out, you don't have to be the high score, you just don't want to be the low score. The elimination format.
Well, it's pretty much shaping up, Chris, the way you saw it. Kind of an ugly, gritty, scrappy type affair here. Fagan, great pickup.
Like it's his job.
No bet.
Nice girlfriend, Emily Mayer, enjoying that one. Beautiful smile from that young lady. And this is your fast, safe pain relief replay brought to you by the makers of Bayer Advanced Aspirin. Belmo, he and Fagan, good mates, as Jason will often say to you. Those two having a little laugh. Was it last year and the year before, we're talking a lot about Belmo, Fagan, and Bill O'Neill, the rat pack of the PBA, those three.
The three amigos.
Yeah, young talents, always kind of rolling in the same circle, and haven't seen Bill O'Neill yet this season. Come on, give the kid a strike.
That's a pretty good shot there, and that won't loosen up your arm swing any.
No. This is where I turn on the Tom Doherty mode. And I just start smiling and having fun and thinking, hey, life could be a heck of a lot worse.
Two in a row for Kretzer.
Interesting note about that Doherty game. He hit the head pin on his first ball of every frame. He got a pin on his second ball of every frame and still shot 100. Couldn't do it on purpose.
No. What do you have, seven or eight splits, something crazy?
Yeah. Done with eight. Only Kretzer struck in that frame. Through eight, it's still Brian on top. 21 better than Fagan. You only need to be in the top three, and Belmo is there. 26 behind Kretzer.
Oh, boy, boy.
I don't think there's any guy out there right now who's saying to himself, well, I got this thing figured out. I'm in good shape.
Kretzer's got to be the closest. Fagan's got to be thinking, I would have thought there would have been enough time. It would have been the time to make a move in and get a look at the different part of the lane.
Back-to-back stone nines for Belmonte.
He's getting close.
Yep. As the oil pattern starts to burn up a bit and he can move in and start using a little more angle, he's going to get tougher and tougher. But I would expect if Mike Fagan makes it through to the next game, you'll see a little bit of that from him as well.
A All few right. who can burn up the oil at a more rapid rate than Belmo.
True that.
Destroys lane patterns. I've never seen anybody take that much oil off a lane, with even with a shiny ball. It's pretty amazing.
Oh yeah.
Blanchard can still force some people to mark in the 10th frame here if he can find a way.
Pretty much done.
That was a better shot too. This is your nightmare.
Yeah.
Your first show. And I mean, how many of us have gone through this right here?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Both good. Had something kind of figured out, get on TV, and
hello, 160.
There's Kretzer, you're right. He's the one guy who seems he's got a little bit more of a better handle of things, but Belmo starting to figure things out. Fagan lurking. Oh my goodness gracious! From bad to worse to miserable.
We're good.
Yeah, once he hit the lane, he had no chance. Nope. It's like hitting ice. Ball never clears his thumb. Hits the lane, hits that oil in the heads.
And the irony is, this is a new spare ball.
See the damage he did to the oil over there. Not to mention his hip. And self-esteem. Amy's going to have to do some counseling tonight.
Come on, Josh. Let's see you slide that over and make this. Yeah, not a foul because he never let go of it.
Because he couldn't let go of it. It's crazy glued in there. So Mike Fagan, Jason Belmonte, and Brian Kretzer move on to match number two, and we'll have it from Vegas when we return. PBA Hall of Famer Mike Aulby is only one of six men to ever collect Pro Bowling's elusive Triple Crown, with wins in the USBC Masters, the Tournament of Champions, and what is now known as the PBA World Championship. Aulby won his first PBA National Championship back in 1979 as a rookie against the great Earl Anthony, and then won it again 6 years later in the 1985 edition, and was ultimately named that year's Player of the Year. Aulby division play of the PBA World Championship rolls on from Las Vegas. Josh Blanchard eliminated with the 139. Kretzer, Fagan, Belmo move on to match number two. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson, Chris Barnes back here with you. Jason Belmonte, kind of a ho-hum 188, four strikes, had two opens. Yet you get the feeling, Randy, he's this close to figuring out the lanes.
Well, he didn't miss the pocket from the sixth frame on the last game. And what Belmo's waiting on or hoping on is that the lanes break down enough to where he can move in and create more angle. And once that happens, he's going to be a handful.
Now, Mike Fagan with a 194. But, Chris, you're saying he needs to make a move immediately or he's out.
That's what I think. Absolutely. I think he played him straight that first game. He thought the scoring pace was going to be low. He was right. Josh had a... You know, he had a train wreck game. I think now he has to move probably eight or nine left with his feet, get his target in on 23, 24, 25 to get left of where Belmo and at least as far left as Kretzer to have a chance to advance to the final.
And there is Kretzer, the guy who had the high score, 231 with eight strikes. Let's see what he has in store here in match number two. Jason Belmonte will start us off here in match number two. Best ever finish here at the PBA World Championship, seventh in 2010.
Good start.
Brian Kretzer, the high man in the opening game, finished second in this tournament, 2003 in Taylor, Michigan, just outside of Detroit. Whoa, late drop of the 10.
Oh, my God.
Here's Fagan, the guy that Chris said had to make a big move here in match number two.
Opting not to do it so far.
Yeah, I was going to say, it hasn't happened yet. Still really straight, Rob.
Hard to argue with that result. Kretzer with the spare.
Michael's targeting around 19. Belmonte and Kretzer both in around 24, 25 at the arrows.
Well, I got to tell you guys, the more bowling balls that go down the lane, I think the more it favors this guy right here.
Making his ninth career TV singles appearance, Jason Belmonte. Two-handed style.
Perfect.
He's got a little hold now. I think you're absolutely right, Randy. He can open it up enough now to get it back. Now he's got a little hold. That shot was 3-6-10 the first game.
Kretzer in the second. Spare strike to start. Now Fagan up here to finish off the second frame. Will this be the frame that he decides to move in? And that is an emphatic no from Mr. Fagan as he begins match two with a double as he continues to dance with the one he brought to Vegas. Belmo looking to start match two with a triple. He's got it figured out.
So once the oil pattern breaks down enough and he can move farther left and open his angle up a little bit to the right with that kind of power, tall order to beat that.
And Jason can keep going left. Keep going left. Unlimited. Keep going left. I mean, he could go left into the crowd if he needed to. We've seen him hang all around the.
And Chris Kretzer's angle is still good enough to give him, in my opinion, pin carry that will still allow him to bowl a good game. He's not too far left yet.
No, he's not too far left yet. The scary thing is Jason's ball speed is 3 miles an hour faster.
Fagan perfect through two. Three for three for Fagan. Michael holding true to his first match style. Will that continue? Match two wraps it up from Vegas when we return. Mike Fagan, three for three. Ditto for his buddy, Jason Belmonte. The PBA World Championship is brought to you by Jack Link's. Jack Link's Beef Jerky, feed your wild side. By Storm, bowlers serving bowlers. Storm is the bowler's company. By Bayer, try Bayer Advanced Aspirin, extra strength pain relief, twice as fast as before. And by Ebonite, bowl to win.
Randy, I'm still waiting on your Christmas present from you. I'm going to give you an idea. You can fire me up an official PBA jersey, customizable jerseys, designs for individuals or teams, still available over at PBA.com. Hurry up. Can you get me a PDW one, maybe?
No, I'm going to get you one with a big, giant ham bone on the front.
Do they make those? If not, they should. And I should get a cut. Jason Belmonte looking to open up, speaking of a ham bone, with an opening ham bone.
Not quite the same response Weber gives you when he gets his ham bone, but pretty exciting messenger nonetheless.
Yeah, late kick of the 10. Here's Kretzer looking for three in a row.
Oh, oh boy.
Brooklyn!
Well, he'll certainly take it. Little reaction there from Kretzer. Kind of guy that seems to take things in stride, maybe a little too much so, according to Fagan.
Brian Kretzer is more of a laid-back guy, you know, just kind of out here and good demeanor, but I don't know if he's got that drive to really to want it as much as Jason Belmonte wants it, and myself, really.
Maybe a good thing for Fagan that Kretzer didn't hear that. Might be the motivation he needs to get it done today. But right now, Fagan and Belmo lead Kretzer by 10 here at the bottom of the fourth.
Well, I can't believe Murphy's Law knew me right there. That's the ring in 10.
Opening four bagger for both Belmo and Fagan here in match number two.
And that's why Mike Fagan is bowling in the World Championships, and I'm sitting here next to you.
Yeah. Honestly, I'm kind of with you. You would think he would be trying to do a little bit more of what this guy's doing.
Drops the nickel to Belmo.
Yeah, Fagan is one of the best in the world at not only playing the gutter, but playing the left gutter. And he's awfully good in between, too. I think sometimes he doesn't believe in himself as much as the rest of us know how good he is, and sometimes tries to play away from where other guys are playing. And I think he can beat just about anybody shot for shot.
Another strike there for Kretzer.
Nice bridge.
Right now in the breaks category, Brian Kretzer way ahead. Brooklyn trip four and another four bagger, or as my friend and colleague likes to call it, a ham bone.
That is back to back to back ham bones.
Cross it off your bucket list, my friend.
That in a 300 game someday. Someday. Fagan looking for five in a row. Yes! Well, let's flash back, guys, to last week. Match number two, PD Dub, Sean Rash. Strike after strike after strike. They took it deep. We were teased with a taste of a double 300 game. Belmo, Fagan, both perfect through five right now. Long ways to go before we start discussing in further detail 300 games.
Rob Stone just cracked open a six-pack right next to me. Yeah, remember last week, Weber had the front eight, Sean Rash had the front nine. Pretty exciting stuff. All of a sudden, this match shaping up to look just like last week. Oof. And of course, Kretzer's best shot doesn't strike.
Got it outside.
Pretty big believer if it all evens out, but sometimes it doesn't even out quite that quickly.
It's
So Fagan's run comes to a close there.
And that's kind of what you would expect, trying to play this oil pattern the way he's trying to play it, if he misses just a crack to the right.
Our friends at Kegel have given us the CAT system, and that was a board right of the last one was high flush. BK and Bum will have more room than that.
He's throwing it at 20 miles an hour, and he's reduced his rev rate. So, I mean, obviously his intent is to go straighter. But with that being said, all it takes is for him to miss a board right and leave a bucket or a 2-5 like he just did.
Yeah.
That big backswing of Fagan gets him a spare.
There are times, though, when you're feeling and you're in good rhythm and you're not afraid to just go out and just pure shot after shot after shot.
And that's Belmo right now, perfect through six. He's on top here. And match number two is buddy Mike Fagan, 12 behind Brian Kretzer, trailing Fagan by 9 pins as we begin the seventh. Seven in a row to open up.
Redonkulous.
Here are Belmo's last 5 frames, courtesy of the CAT system. And check out the consistency in speed and position at the arrows midway down the lane. All of them nearly identical, just freakishly good stuff there. Kretzer, a little right of target.
Half a loaf.
Oh, Kretzer. God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God.
Crosses about 23. This one looks pretty good, but this left lane pretty consistently has been tighter down lane throughout our whole World Series of Bowling shows. And you miss it just a little bit. Doesn't make it.
Kretzer cleans that one up in the seventh.
Well, I know Mike has been playing to the right, but I really feel like he should be in through here.
Leaves the seven.
Obviously, at this point, he's pot committed. And he's going to stay where he's at, and he's going to try and out bowl these guys. And so far, he's doing a pretty good job of it. He's throwing better shots than anyone, but he's got the toughest road to get there.
Well, I don't know if I agree with better than anyone. I mean, this guy's making some pretty good shots, too. But the bottom line is, if Michael Fagan didn't think he had a chance doing what he's doing, he wouldn't be doing it.
Boom!
You know what we call that, Rob? You call a four-bagger a ham bone. I call that mungus.
As humongous?
As in humongous. This is just ridiculously nasty. That kind of speed with those RPMs at that angle, it's almost unfair.
Belmo just 4 strikes away now from a very elusive goal. Kretzer gets the pocket to collapse there.
He's only down by 13. He strikes in the eighth. He still has a ninth and 10th frame. Not over yet for Brian Kretzer.
Fagan, after that lights out start, 5 straight strikes, has gone spare. Here he is in the eighth. The lead over Kretzer. Top two move on, and the 10 pin is resilient. And Fagan mumbling to himself, ball change.
It almost seems like his pocket is really, really narrow, whereas Belmonte's is really wide.
All right, it's the whole idea of creating revolutions, creating entry angle. You make your pocket wide. He's purposely shutting it down a little bit, making it narrower.
9 in a row for Belmo. Fagan and Kretzer bowling for second right now here in the second match.
Care for Mike Fagan after 8 frames. Belmonte, Fagan, Kretzer trails by 12.
Fagan eyeballing the leaderboard that the fans and the bowlers can see. So he and Kretzer are going at it. The other storyline is the big one. Jason Belmonte, flawless through 9. Fagan will watch behind Kretzer as Belmo mulls a perfect game. Oh, the left side, a late delay collapse.
Just cut the deficit to two.
Fagan's rebuttal here in the ninth. Through the nose.
Mike Fagan's in trouble. Big trouble.
Fagan will think about it. Belmonte will step up in the 10th. Nothing but strikes from the Australian thus far. The Bo Derek. Perfect 10 from Belmo thus far.
You couldn't wait to say that.
Oh, he's handling it very well. I don't know what the internal body temperature is right there and the heart rate. But from the outside, Belmo handling it better than his friend Mike Fagan, who is collapsing right now. We switch back to the left lane. Two strikes away from perfection. Jason Belmonte. One away.
Get ready, Rob Stone. You may be able to cross something off your bucket list.
Let me just pull it out of my pocket. I'm ready. Got my pen set. Kretzer. Trying to close out Fagan here and move on. Didn't like it.
God.
That's huge. He needs to fill 18 pins in the 10th frame to shut Fagan out. Breaking that down to get 9. Tremendous break.
But first, Jason Belmonte. It's only happened 20 times under the lights of TV. A perfect game. One strike away from a 300. Yeah! Give it to him! Finally, I've seen a 300 game.
Yeah, you could have bet $1 million. That game wasn't happening.
Oh, that's awesome. We were teased last week by PD Dub and Sean Rash, and Belmo delivers the goods. Another look at his 12th shot. Everybody standing up. Holds the pose, celebrates. Now it turns to Fagan in the 10th. That 201, big strike.
Right now, Brian Kretzer can advance to the final match against Jason Belmonte, but he needs 9 pins on this ball.
He's got 8.
8-10 for 8. Mike Fagan needs 2 more strikes to tie.
You gotta be freaking kidding me.
Belmo already in the books with a 300. Kretzer done at 231. Fagan, 2 strikes to equalize.
And makes a ball change in the 10th frame.
Yeah, I think this is a great move to make a ball change. The one he was using, obviously not quite good enough. He hadn't struck in 4 shots since the 5th frame. Makes the blind ball change in the 10th. He's got to have all 3. If you don't think you can throw 3 with the one you got, you got to make a change.
Needs 2 to tie.
Got to go.
Nope. Kretzer moves on. Belmo. Perfection. Kretzer, 231. They both advance. Ah, the smile says it all.
a 300 game for Belmo, and he moves on. His work, though, not done yet today. Welcome back to Las Vegas, and Jason Belmonte, $10,000 richer. That's the bonus for dropping a 300 game under the lights. CEO Jeff Reese handing it off. Jason celebrates, and Randy slides in for the interview.
Congratulations, the 21st player to do it in PBA history. Talk about what you were thinking getting up in the 10th frame.
I just wanted to hit what I was looking and let the ball do the rest. I mean, I knew I'd advance to the next round, so I knew there wasn't any of that pressure on me. And I wanted to go down in history as one of the guys who have done it. So I tried to throw three really good shots, and it came out.
Congratulations. Great
Cheers,
job. Man.
I appreciate it. Cheers.
So a 300 game is great and fine and dandy, but he's still got some work to do. Belmo, Kretzer, the winner, moves on to the Final Four of the first major of the year, the PBA World Championship. Welcome back to Las Vegas. PBA World Championship Aulby Division is down to its final match. Mike Fagan eliminated with a 220. Belmo's 300 propels him to match number three. Brian Kretzer, 231, was enough. You are now Jason Best Monty. Like that one. Nice play on words. Here's today's keys to victory, brought to you by the makers of Alka-Seltzer plus liquid gels.
Belmonte has to avoid the 300 game hangover.
And Kretzer, he just needs to chase left. He needs a ball that gets through it cleaner, has to get slower, and be able to use some of that area that Jason's created.
Oh, God.
Didn't like it. Almost became a Brooklyn strike.
Afraid to go that way with the ball.
Not a good thing when you're doubting yourself in the first frame.
So freaking afraid to go that way with the ball.
Does he mean he's afraid to go right with it?
Yeah, I think he's afraid to get it to the right. And he's so good at sliding into the left gutter cap and just lofting and pushing across the head pin. It just seems like to me he needs to play to his strength, which is get soft, get on a little bit, and get a shiny enough ball that pushes to it, and then we'll come off of it. I think the ball looked a little too dull at the end of the last match, and he was a little too square on it.
This guy's not afraid to throw it to the right.
Or throw it hard.
Looking for his 13th straight strike here. That looks familiar. We take a look at the arsenal that Jason Belmonte has at his disposal.
Yeah, he's run a critical theory. He can actually step it up one notch if he wanted to go stronger, go to a defiant. But after shooting 300 with that ball, I think I'd probably stay with it.
Some sage advice, Randy. I mean, you've seen nothing to make you think that he needs to alter anything at all.
This guy's in his wheelhouse right now.
So Belmo after the strike.
So he proves he's human. But right now, Brian Kretzer's got to feel like he's shark diving without a cage. And we are on the shark pattern.
He's wearing a meat vest, too. Toe to head, Kretzer, 9 spare in the first.
did not like his footing, and it became a Brooklyn effort.
I can't make this.
That time he slipped.
So afraid that ball.
Almost misses the head pin, running away left, leaves the 3-6-9. And this is not something you want to shoot at on a regular basis.
Yeah, the demons are barking in his head right now. Good cover, though.
Great cover. Yeah.
And he'll go backstage and do some adjusting.
Well, he was using a Marvel Pearl. He is now going to something else. Not sure what it is yet. He didn't get a good enough look. Yep, going to a Defiant, going stronger.
Making a move here in the third frame.
I would guess he's going to slide a lot deeper, get his hand way around it, and try and push it down the lane first.
I can manage that.
I think he went to something that he actually trusts will have a better chance of hooking back when he throws it right.
Saw some of that during the week when you pushed, got pushed way left. If you didn't have enough surface, once you got it through the front, you could get through the middle and the back too. So even if it's a little more surface than he'd like to use, he's got to get a feel for the lane. Got to feel like his ball is going to pick up and hook and then do the things that he does.
Belmo stepping up here in the third. Strike, spare, his lead at four.
Remember the keys? No 300 game hangover. Right now, Jason Belmonte still a little fuzzy.
Yeah, trying to hydrate the head right now.
Yeah.
I know that feeling.
Drop a couple of aspirin, take some water, clear the head. This one's left, and it's going to be a Brooklyn strike. And he's like, okay, let's not do that again.
Strike there for Belmo, and he's trying to move on to the PBA World Championship Finals next Sunday, 1 Eastern, right here on ESPN. Oscu Palermo, Ryan Schaefer, Sean Rash have already booked their tickets. Belmo trying to join them. Kretzer, though, not going without a fight. He's down 14. Needs a strike here in the fourth. It would be his first of this match. And he gets it.
Well, you heard him the last time he threw the ball, or the first time he threw the ball on the left lane, Chris. He said, I can manage that.
Once he sees his ball hook in the right place, he's a field guy. He's a lot like Pete Weber. Now he's now he can make a run at him.
Kretzer, a 231 in his first match, and a 231 in match number two as well.
Completely different. Mm-hmm. Completely different types of games, though. Second game, he got much more fortunate.
Oh. My little ball should not solid nine. There's no way it should solid nine. Come on. Well, it hits hard enough. I'm just 8-10 and I solid nine.
Here you can look at the first four shots that that BK threw, and it was a little bit of a mess. Some left, some right. Looks a little bit like my golf game. The last three shots, though, have all been on target, and he's much closer, but I'm not so sure Jason's going to let him breathe.
Thank you, Kegel, for the computer-aided tracking system. Kegel, the official training center of the PBA, located Central Florida, about 50 minutes south of myself, Jason Couch, and Norm Duke.
Three in a row for Belmo.
Yeah, I think you're right, Chris. I'm not sure he's going to give Kretzer very much breathing room. It's too bad. Ryan found a nice shot, a nice line with the ball change, struck, and then solid nine right behind it. Belmonte goes Brooklyn and takes advantage of that great break by throwing two really good shots after it.
Belmo made five televised appearances last season. This is his second already. Was involved in the World Bowling Tour Finals, which was won by Mika Koivuniemi. The runner-up was Sean Rash. Rash has already advanced to next Sunday's PBA World Championship Final Four. Belmo trying to join him. Here's his effort in the sixth. A couple late drops. That could have been an ugly split.
Some nines are a lot better than others.
Little left of target, looks like. This ball breaks loose, goes right through the nose, and it could have been a big four. Instead, it's just the four.
Oh, yeah.
Hit check that one. And Belmo remains clean through six. Kretzer down 23. Nine spare, seven spare. Nine spare, strike, nine spare. He's on the right lane, which is where his first and only strike this match came. Ten. Do not adjust your audio. That was Brian Kretzer.
No, it's not gonna hook.
Marries those two. Having the easiest of times out here right now. What goes through his mind at moments like this? Well, whatever it is, he tries to keep it to himself.
I deal with the mental part of it mainly as you stay even keel. You know, a lot of guys out here get real animated, whether it's a good shot or a bad shot. They show their emotions. I kind of just keep them bottled up and allow my, you know, not to get too excited or too mad, because you gotta stay focused every shot. And if you allow your brain to start thinking about bad shots, or, you know, oh, I ran that one out and that was awesome, and then you forget about your job at hand.
There is Kretzer in the seventh, still seeking his second strike, down 25. And he needs to start getting some momentum. That's not gonna help.
He's just completely out of rhythm now. The field guy that doesn't have a good feel for the lane is in big, big trouble. There's just nothing to fall back on.
Belmo has had some fortuitous drops here. Look at this. Could have been ugly. Instead, it was a nine. Again on the left lane, another fortunate nine. Like you said, Chris, some nines are better than others. Belmo up 39. Bottom of the seventh, coming off a spare.
Knife at a gunfight. That shot hasn't made it back to the head pin for really anybody, and not only does his make it back, but he throws the head pin around and cleans up all the mess.
Strike number five for Belmonte, looking for a double here. What pin was that that just hopped up?
Not sure, but he left the 5-10. He moved even deeper and tried to go with loft and just never got it going to the right, in the right direction. Now in jeopardy of his first open frame, or yes, his first open frame through eight.
He's having a slight 300 game hangover right now.
He's beat up the soil pattern pretty good, and now it almost looks like he's run out of room on the left lane.
That's the first time you've ever left a 5-10.
Second time. I was three the first time.
So both Kretzer and Belmo coming off open frames. Brian down 27. Here he is to close out the eighth.
like Brian just keeps moving into more and more of Belmo's hook.
Yeah, keeps moving into more and more trouble.
About now is when Mike's strategy would have looked pretty good.
Yeah.
Still wouldn't have been on a strike, but.
Valuable pickup that keeps him with at least shouting range.
Best he can, Rob, the best he can shoot is 200. Belmonte is actually at 207 right now.
Still without a strike on that left lane, and only one here in match number three.
Back to the weaker ball there, trying to get it back to go through the front of the lane, give himself a chance. Got through the front, but didn't go through the pins.
Yeah, it looked like he tried to give it some more gas, some more hand, a little loft. Got it through the front part, like you said, but it was DOA when it got to the 1-3.
It's like we talked about at the very beginning, that on the fresh, he could say softer would be good. Belmo would eventually beat up the lane. It was going to be hard for him to strike.
Off the open frame. Maybe looking at another one.
Okay.
6-7-10 split.
Pretty close.
Whew.
He needs a mark. Any kind of mark in the 10th frame, and he'll lock out Brian Kretzer. If he opens again, Kretzer can win.
Back-to-back open frames for Belmo, who had a 300 game in match two.
Any kind of mark right here.
There's your mark.
That's a good one.
Yes.
He just punched his ticket to the dance.
Needs just four pins. The dirty work is done. Time to close the door. Big loft, splash, get six, that's enough. And your number three overall seed, Jason Belmonte, advances. Sean Rash, Ryan Schaefer, Oscu Palermo waiting in the wings next Sunday for our first major. And we'll hear from Belmo when our coverage of the PBA World Championship from Las Vegas returns. PBA World Championship is brought to you by Barbasol. Start your day cool with new Arctic Chill Shaving Cream from Barbasol. Better by Barbasol. By Brunswick. Find your next ball at bowlwithbrunswick.com. By Geico. Saving people money on more than just car insurance. And by DV8. We are DV8. Tonight, we bowl. Welcome back to Las Vegas, and what a set of finalists we have for you next week at the PBA World Championship. Oscu Palermo, Ryan Schaefer, Sean Rash, and now Jason Belmonte added to the list. Time now for our Geico Championship recap. Match number one, Josh Blanchard in his first match under the TV lights did not go the way the young man wanted it, and he was quickly sent packing. Match two, Mike Fagan, 220. Not enough, because Belmo dropped a 300. Brian Kretzer's 231, also enough to advance. In match three, Belmo strikes in the first
third, fourth, fifth, and he just kind of kept on grinding it out, and he won it. He's standing by with Randy.
Jason, it looked like you were suffering from a little bit of a 300 hangover there that last game. What was going on with the oil pattern and the lanes?
Yeah, you know, the second half of that game, we both started to see really early hook, and then for me in particular, it just read that fraction early, and I couldn't get it to the break point where I wanted to. So if this game had gone on for another five more frames, I don't know what I would have done. I was pretty lucky that the game ended when it did.
How does it feel now to add your list of the four finalists that are going to compete for the World Championships? You're looking for your first major.
Yeah, I'm really excited. This is my first major championship opportunity to win, and I feel great. And the guys who I'm bowling against, you know, they're awesome bowlers. It's going to be a great show, and I really can't wait to lace up against them.
Well, thanks a lot, and best of luck to you.
Cheers, mate. I appreciate it.
Now the 2009 PBA Rookie of the Year looking for a second tour title and first major. Will he get it? Find out with us next Sunday right back here in Las Vegas. Belmo, Rash, Schaefer, Palermo for the first major of the season. Jason Belmonte, a perfect 300 game in match number two, the 21st time it's ever happened under the TV lights, and he moves on. For Randy and Chris, I'm Rob Stone. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.